on the other hand, if I was the window seat guy, I would want the middle seat guy to become the new aisle seat guy. I wouldn't see moving as rude. I would just want his gross, disgusting body as far away from me as possible. That's not rude. But on the other
That's
hand,
just mean.
Most people don't even mind being this.
That is mean.
Struggling socially, I don't know. Now imagine that same situation, but with urinals. If you're in the middle urinal, do you move halfway through to the other urinal? Because I would. Are you supposed to talk to people when you're sitting 2 inches away from them? I always felt like I should say something, like, hey, did you see the game last night? I didn't know, I was too busy drawing cartoons. But I realized that this is a two-way street. I'm worried about not talking to someone, but they're not talking to me either. We both agreed that there's this unwritten contract between us that we're not even going to look at each other. It got me thinking about strangers and specifically how I treat them. And how I can make money off of them. Hey-oh! I'm just kidding, that was a joke. For most of my life, I would go out of my way to avoid talking to people. I would stay in my lane, mind my own business, no eye contact. If everyone's using a urinal, I'd have to pee tomorrow. Yes, I'm lonely. But now that YouTube's the thing, I'm interacting with strangers more often than I've had to in my entire life. So I've been thinking a lot about strangers. And first of all, I think the word stranger is already an insulting label for someone just because you don't know their name. Oh, I don't know this person. They're a stranger. They're strange. I'm the normal one. They're the freaks. They probably murder people with an axe. It's always the go-to profession of a stranger, an axe murderer. But the people you see throughout your day are all humans with their own hopes and dreams. And some of them may hope to kill you, but you'll never know because you never take the time to get to know them. So I think that the people you see throughout your daily life aren't strangers. They're potential friends. Except for the weird ones, obviously. Stay away from them. And yes, I'm telling you to judge people based on their appearance. They're the ones that chose to wear anime shirts in public. Like, okay? So, back to the bus scenario. I'm sitting right next to this fellow human being. So far, there's not a single reason why I should dislike this person. But I don't know why, if you put him and me on a bus next to each other, I want him as far away from me as possible. Just stop touching my shoulder! So that was the last time I took the bus. Unfortunately, that's not the only place you meet strangers. One time I was at Home Depot, and I was looking for jumper cables, and I couldn't find them anywhere. And I don't know if I'm the only human that's like this, but I will try everything in my power to not talk to a sales associate. I guess it's because I know they get paid minimum wage, and their life sucks, and I just want to leave them alone and not make their job any harder than it has to be. But asking employees for help isn't even bothering them that much. In fact, I think it's part of their job? Like, what's the worst thing they're gonna say? Ugh! You don't know where one specific item is? Everyone else knows. Did you even look? You're in the jumper cable aisle, idiot. No one's gonna think that. So feeling desperate, I mustered up what little courage I had and swaggered up to someone wearing an orange vest and said, excuse me, do you know where the jumper cables are? I work here. Oh, you don't work here? And then he walked away. And then he waddled away, waddled on. And then the very next day, bum, bum, bum. So I think the logical thing to do in that situation would have been to find someone who does work there. But I left the store because I didn't want to run into that same guy again. But I also bought a hammer because I didn't want people to think that I stole something. So...
Oh yeah.
And by the way, if you wear an orange vest to Home Depot, just expect people to ask you for help. Same goes for people who wear red shirt to Target. You'd think I'd learn from my mistakes, but no, I have a bunch more examples. When my book came out, my publisher said that it was going to be carried at Barnes & Noble. And I thought that was super duper cool and wanted to see my book in the wild. Not to buy or anything, just to have a look at it. So I took my friend Adam from Something Else YT, and we went to the local Barnes & Noble and started our search. We looked in the humor section, didn't find it. Then we checked the new release section, it wasn't there either. Then we looked
at the best-selling
section, then the religious section, but we couldn't find the book anywhere. So either
the publisher lied,
or they had already sold out. But just to be sure, I asked one of the workers, hey, do you guys have a book by The Odd Ones Out? He kind of looks like this. And the worker typed something out on his computer and said, oh yeah, we got those in the back. We just haven't put them out yet. So then he went to the back room, brought out a copy, and handed it to me saying, here you go, kid. And I thought, well, great.
I can't just hand it
back to the guy and say, oh no, that's okay. I didn't want to buy it. I just wanted to have a look at it. Do you know how inconvenient that would be? So the only less awkward option I could think of was to buy my own book. And you know what? I'd get a couple cents back from this purchase, so it would have been a total loss. But Adam, being the more sensible one, said,
dude, this is ridiculous. You you have to complain.
Today, went to the worker and said...
So he actually wrote this book. He just wanted to get a look at it, like, in the wild.
And the worker said, oh, that's so cool. Do you want to sign our copies? And then I thought, well, hold on. You're not even going to ask me for my ID? How do you know I actually wrote this book and I'm not some guy trying to deface someone else's? And then the guy gave me a whole stack of my books and I signed them all. Last story before I go. I was in the hallway of a building and me and this potential friend crossed paths. He said, hello, and I was going to respond with, hello, and how's it going? But I combined the two and ended up saying, how? And then I jumped out a window and fell to my death. I can't rationalize that behavior. Maybe I spend too much time on the computer, I'm not used to looking at real people's faces, but I'm trying to change. Don't get me wrong, going to conventions and meeting fans has helped me a lot with talking to people. Granted, those conversations are usually one-sided and a real stranger will already know who I am, but they've still helped me. Now, you might be expecting me to give you advice on overcoming social anxiety, but if you watch this video, you know I'm not the most qualified to give that advice, but I'll try my best. I know it's hard to feel confident and I'm still working on it, but you have to understand that we're all people and we all have things that we're struggling with. And in reality, we're not all watching or caring about every little thing that other people do. We're all too busy worrying about what other people think of us. So with enough practice and believing in yourself, you can show the world your true colors, and I think you'll find that people are a lot nicer than you think. So if you're the middle seat guy on the bus and you have to decide whether or not to move, do whatever you want. No one cares. Just stop touching my shoulders. Hey everyone, I know it's been a while. Thank you for being patient with this video. May has been a really busy month because some of you might know that May is my birthday month and I don't work on my birthday month, so... If there's a lesson you should take away from this video is don't worry about being awkward.
I don't know if I can be with him. Should I just bail?
Science fair.
I was talking to a friend saying, oh, I know, I can do a video about the science fair and, you know, talk about how much it sucks. And she said, oh, at my school, we didn't do the science fair. That got me wondering, did other people not do the science fair? So I did my own science experiment on Twitter. I ran a poll and asked you guys if you did the science fair and whether or not you enjoyed doing it. And 58% of you said you didn't have to do the science fair. Like, that was way more than I expected. That's the majority. I've renamed this group of people the Lucky Ones. And when I asked if you enjoyed doing it, 21% of you said you did enjoy it, and 21% of you said you didn't. I know Twitter polls aren't the most accurate sources of data, but I think it's safe to say that this is a pretty split issue. Now, I'm in the 21% of people who didn't enjoy the science fair. And don't get me wrong, I love science. Well, okay, that might not be true. I really hated biology and chemistry. That was just a mess. But physics!
Was okay. Maybe I don't like science.
I just like space and watching these. Bill and Neil, they're my buddies. Except Neil did hurt my feelings one time. We'll get back to that later. Alright, so let me briefly go over what the science fair is for you lucky ones who didn't have to deal with that. Apparently, it's a very American thing, right guys?
Yeah.
Basically, we started doing them, I want to say around 4th grade, and we would do this every year up until the 10th grade. The whole class would spend all day researching a topic that interests them, and then we'd have to come up with a question that we could run an experiment on. An example of these questions are, does the temperature of a battery affect how long it will last? What color light produces the most heat? How does the shape of a rocket's fins affect its travel? All of which are projects I did. Basically, this was supposed to teach you about the scientific method, but what it really did was teach us how to procrastinate and make up data. And on paper, you might think, oh, that sounds like fun. I wish my school did the science fair. No. Here are some flaws with the science fair. First, you got the option to work with a partner. And of course, you want to work with a partner so you can split up the work and not do as much. Now, since I didn't have any friends, I would partner up with someone that no one else wanted to partner up with. But they wouldn't do any of the work. I only did the science fair with a partner once. From 5th grade on, I did my science fair projects alone. The second problem is that we had to come up with a question all on our own. And you gotta understand, we were just kids. We don't think as cognitively as scientists do, okay? Just a couple years ago, we still believed in Santa Claus. Except for me, my family didn't do Santa Claus. And now you want us to wonder if the ratio of a cylinder will affect its buoyancy? Like, come on. And also, we don't have access to any resources. You know, the science fair is a lot like an episode of Mythbusters. But what sets apart the Mythbusters from your average 4th grader is that they're really smart engineers who have access to experiments.
can't even drive to Walmart ourselves.